Hello everyone, I am Demented Kirby, and welcome to my channel, the Commander Tavern. The Commander Tavern is a channel dedicated to my favorite Magic the Gathering format. The Brewery is a series on this channel showcasing my spicy brews under the deck text. On this episode of The Brewery, I'll be discussing my take on an uncommander voted on by the viewers, X. If you like this deck or any of the cards I'll be mentioning throughout the video, please consider using my TCG Player affiliate link when purchasing those cards. You can find that link down in the description. It'll really help out the channel. Other ways you can help support the channel is with my Patreon. Patrons get early access to scheduled videos on YouTube, and higher tier patrons get access to the VIP section of my Discord server as well. You can find a link to that down in the description too. In fact, patrons got a chance to see this video earlier. Alright, let's get back to the episode. X is a 2-2 human spy for 1 blue and 1 black. X presents an interesting mechanic whereas we can activate his abilities if he's in an opponent's hand. In order to get him into an opponent's hand, we have to pay 2 mana and tap him. Then, once there, we pay 5 mana to play any card from that opponent's hand without paying its mana cost. Due to the way this ability is worded, we could even play lands from an opponent's hand, assuming we're able to. In this sense, I feel like X is similar to Send Triplets, since we're playing things from an opponent's hand. However, X is tamer, since it has to be in a particular opponent's hand, and we also don't have access to white. Also, each spell we cast or land we play costs 5 mana to do so, regardless of the spell's casting cost. With this deck, you're basically playing with your opponent's deck. In order to make it easier which opponents to choose, it's best if we're able to see all of their hands. Telepathy, Seer's Vision, and Glasses of Urza help us do just that. Telepathy is potentially the best one since you can cast this turn 1 and then X turn 2, while knowing which opponent to send X to on turn 3. That being said, telepathy might make some players want to target it since it forces everyone to play with their hands revealed. Same with Seer's Vision. This one costs 3 more to cast, but you can also use it to force an opponent to discard any card of your choosing. Glasses of Urza is the tamest one since it's not a static effect. You're not forcing opponents to play with their hands revealed, so they might not be as against it as telepathy or Seer's Vision. It might seem odd to play with these effects since whoever has X in their hand has to play with him revealed anyways. But if someone has a better hand, you might want to move X into that player's hand. Breathstealer's Crypt is also included as a way to at least see what everyone is drawing. This way we can get an idea of what players have in their hand, but we do have to keep a mental track of it. Additionally, any creature that player wants to keep will cost them 3 life. This deck doesn't run that many creatures, so this enchantment won't hurt us as much as other players. The only downside is revealing our draws. Since X's ability isn't time restricted, we can cast any instant in that player's hand at any time. But if we want to cast anything outside of our turn, we're going to need Vedalken Orrery or Leyline of Anticipation. Thanks to these, we're even able to play from an opponent's hand whatever they drew in response to their main phase, thus preventing them from playing whichever card they've drawn. Keep in mind that this only lets you single out one player, so you do have to do quite the politicking to not have to worry about the rest of the table. Rings of Brighthearth lets you duplicate X's effect for just 2 more mana. It might seem like a lot to keep 7 mana open, but at that point it should be because your opponent's hand is better than yours and you're paying 2 cards for just 7 mana between the two of them. So it's essentially 3.5 mana per card, which is better than 5 mana per card. Speaking of mana, the deck can appear mana hungry. Being non-green doesn't help in ramping, so the deck has to make do with mana rocks. Chrome Mox, Talisman of Dominance, Dimir Signet, and Arcane Signet help us fix our own mana, since these mana rocks can only provide blue and or black mana. However, since we're stealing our opponent's cards, we need to be able to generate any colored mana. That's why the deck is running Mox Opal, Mox Diamond, Gilded Lotus, Coveted Jewel, and Chromatic Lantern in order to generate any colored mana, as well as Fulwar Stone in order to generate any mana our opponents can generate. However, we don't just need colored mana. X's activated ability is 3 generic, 1 blue and 1 black. I'm running Mana Crypt, Mana Vault, Soul Ring, and Thrine Dynamo in order to compensate for the generic cost. The deck isn't limited to just mana rocks. Although we can't ramp with spells, Burnished Heart and Walking Atlas help with getting lands onto the battlefield. We can ramp 2 basics with Burnished Heart while the Atlas helps us drop a land from our hand. This is great since we can steal a land from an opponent without missing our own land drop. Tricked Mage can also help ramp for mana rocks, especially the 0 costed and 1 costed ones. It also provides a body for chump blocking. The deck can also produce a bunch of mana with Urborg, Tomb of Yawgmoth, and Cabal Coffers. Since the deck only has 2 colors, Cabal Coffers isn't bad without Urborg. Either way, it's not taking up a land slot, being as there's still 37 slots for mana producing lands in the deck. Last but not least, the deck is running Issachron Scepter and Dramatic Reversal. Imprinting Dramatic Reversal on Issachron Scepter is a way to generate infinite mana if we have enough mana rocks on the battlefield. On its own, this can help us cast every card from every hand. Once we finish playing everything in an opponent's hand, we move X to another hand and then repeat. Swiftfoot Boots and Lightning Greaves help give X that haste needed to tap the turn he enters the battlefield. It also protects him as well. Obviously, we can also cast all the cards in our own hand. But with some of the mana sinks in the deck, Dramatic Scepter is an instant win. But we'll see those mana sinks soon enough. Even though we're taking care of one opponent by denying them of their own deck with X, we still have to worry about the rest of the table. The deck runs a slew of counterspells in order to protect our board state, especially against cards like an overloaded Vandal Blast or discard outlets. Discarding X returns him to our command zone, and we want to keep him in an opponent's hand. Counterspell, Mana Drain, Swan Song, Force of Will, Force of Negation, Pact of Negation, and Negate all help with solving the problem before it even becomes one. Curiously enough though, with this type of deck, we even have the luxury of letting some threats actually hit the table. Remember that we only want to protect our board state and prevent players from discarding X. We can get rid of threats by bouncing them. At instant speed, we have Cyclonic Rift and Evacuation. An overloaded Cyclonic Rift sends every non-land permanent we don't control to their owner's hands, while Evacuation sends all creatures to their owner's hands. What's great about this is that we can then try and cast those permanents returned with X later on. Apart from the fact that these can protect us against a Horde or an Alpha Strike, so there's that too. Devastation Tide, Flood of Tears, and Crush of Tentacles can do the same but at sorcery speed, unless you have a Dokkan Ori or Leyline of Anticipation in play, obviously. Unfortunately, these also return anything we've stolen to their owner's hands, so use these only when absolutely necessary. We might be keeping an opponent down by stealing their things with X, but we have other opponents to worry about as well. So bouncing back everything is a good way to keep the status quo. If worse comes to worse, we can just nuke the board with Damnation. However, if we only need to bounce things a target at a time, Tradewind Winder is good for that. Its ability doesn't require mana to use, so it's definitely great to use in response or at the end of someone's turn. It can also return a land to a hand, so we can also use it to keep another opponent locked out of the game. We can also get rid of single targets with Phoebe Head of Sneak. She doesn't outright get rid of creatures, but for just 4 mana, she can make a creature vanilla while also stealing their text box. This means that she gains all of those abilities. So not only can you use this ability to deny opponents of their creatures, but to also use those abilities for yourself. And in order to have these responses at hand, we have to not run out of steam. So the deck does have ways to keep your hand full of cards. Stroke of Genius, Blue Sun Zenith, and Pull from Tomorrow are some of those mana sinks that I mentioned earlier. Not only can we draw X cards at instant speed, but we can also use infinite mana and Stroke of Genius or Blue Sun Zenith to deck a player out of the game. We can also use draw cards with Endless Atlas. Being a two-colored deck means that we'll more than likely have either 3 basic lands of swamps or islands in order to activate it. Since we'll undoubtedly be in control of plenty of cards we don't own, Agent of Treachery will have us draw 3 cards at the beginning of our end step. It can also steal a permanent when it enters the battlefield. It might be a bit costly at 7 mana, but the deck does produce a ton of mana, so it shouldn't be a problem. Since we don't want our victims to run out of cards either, especially since we're playing with their decks, it's ideal to have everyone drawing cards. Howling Mind and Font of Mythos have the entire table drawing cards. Howling Mind and Font of Mythos are great because they're static and don't require mana or any kind of activation. Temple Bell and Otherworld Alice require tapping to use, so at least you use when the table draws. This also plays into the political aspects of the deck. We're keeping an opponent in check with X, but we're also helping the rest of the table with drawing cards. The opponent with X in their hand is drawing into even more things for us to play. Price of Knowledge and Folio of Fancies are included in order for players to not have to discard at the end of each turn. If players are able to discard, then they're clearly going to discard X. At first, it might seem too beneficial to help opponents by letting them draw cards, but recall that the deck is running Breathstealer's Crypt, which will ping them for 3 life for each creature they keep. Price of Progress hurts them as well if they have too many cards during their upkeep. Folio of Fancies is also another mana sink in which everyone can draw X cards. As long as you have more cards in your library than opponents, you can deck them to win the game. In order to guarantee that, Folio of Fancies also lets you mill opponents. Or you can just invest all that mana into Exsanguinate and potentially win that way. If not, then at least you can sink enough mana into it to gain a bunch of life at the expense of your opponents. With infinite mana, you can also win the game outright with it. If we can find what we're looking for by digging through the deck, we can also just tutor for it. Tribute Mage is used to tutor for Isochron Scepter, while Spellseeker is used to tutor for Dramatic Reversal. So this helps in making the Dramatic Scepter combo more consistent. The deck's also running Tesseract the Seeker. Tesseract can tutor for Isochron Scepter as well as any other artifact in the deck. This is especially useful for potentially getting a Mana Rock each turn. Additionally, you can also uptick him to untap 2 Mana Rocks. Mystical Tutor is an additional way to tutor for Dramatic Reversal, but can also be used to tutor for Counterspells, Cyclonic Rift, or Evacuation. The deck's also running Vampiric Tutor and Demonic Tutor in order to tutor for anything the deck needs. The deck doesn't live or die by the Dramatic Scepter combo, so there's no need to run so many tutors. But being in blue and black means that we can at least run a couple just in case for the consistency's sake. Mystic Sanctuary is included as a way to recover an instant or sorcery without really taking up a slot in the deck. More often than not, it won't enter the battlefield tapped, which is the entire point of running it, and it taps for colored mana. It's also an island, so it can be tutored for with a fetch land. Speaking of which, the rest of the deck are just the lands. The deck's running all 8 fetch lands, Command Tower, City of Brass, Mana Confluence, Underground Sea, Underground River, Watery Grave, and Tainted Isle. For mana fixing, as well as Ancient Tomb and Temple of the False God for the multiple mana. And finally, 9 of each basic land. This brew is just an idea of how to build around X. When done right, you can use X to keep an opponent from playing their cards while you're playing them instead. Also, you could potentially keep another opponent out from playing by always bouncing one of their lands each turn with Tradewind Rider. This might seem a bit hardcore for an uncommander deck, but just because the commander is silver bordered doesn't mean you're not able to brew a semi-competitive deck with it. If you're interested in the decklist of this spicy brew of mine, you can find a link to it down in the description. I would like to thank all my patrons for supporting me, and a quick shout out to all my higher tier patrons, the Brewers, for their patronage. I'd also like to thank anyone using my TCG Player affiliate link. That also helps out the channel. And to everyone, thanks for watching this episode of the Brewery on the Commander Tavern. This episode in particular was thanks to your participation on the vote I posted last week. I am Demented Kirby, and happy brewing.